down the ice, and Yakupov has a breakaway. Here's Yakupov. Shot scores! Nail Yakupov!
His draft interview was the worst interview I've ever had in my life.
From the Sarnia Sting, Nail Yakupov.
Because he was defiant and obnoxious.
Nail Yakupov!
Nail Yakupov. And first off, he seemed insulted that we were interviewing him, and we had the fifth pick. And he seemed insulted that, well, I'm not going to be there at five. Why are you interviewing me?
So this is when your paycheck come in, and you have huge money in your pockets, you know?
John Lilly, one of our scouts, you know Lilly's, I think, right?
Yep.
So John Lilly almost fought him in the interview.
The date is October 6th, 1993. Michael Jordan has just announced his first retirement from the NBA, but the biggest event of that day was easily the birth of the man himself, Nail Yakupov. Born in Nizhnekamsk. Yes, we're gonna go with that. Nail Yakupov grew up as a huge hockey fan, first skating when he was 4 years old, had pretty much the typical interests of a kid, played a lot of soccer, played a lot of hockey, but he would not realize the path that hockey would give him to reach the NHL and be a first overall pick. But Nail Yakupov's hockey career would see some significant heights, but also some insufferable lows. From Russian hockey stardom to the worst first overall pick in NHL history, this is the downfall of Nail Yakupov. But if you've been enjoying the video thus far, make sure you hit that subscribe button, support some good old hockey content here on YouTube. Last time I checked, about 65% of the people that have watched the channel over the last month are not subscribed, so get on it and join the Grav Gang. But today, our journey starts out in 2009 in the MHL, from humble beginnings and the rise of the next Russian sensation. The Nail Yakupov hype train mostly started around 2009, and that's where it really started to get some fantastic traction. Back in 2008, he played mostly in the U16 Russian tier, but then in 2009-2010, fully stepped up into the MHL, getting 6 points, 4 goals, 2 assists, and 14 games played. That was good enough to get him the second overall spot in the CHL import draft, and the Sarnia Sting, although making a risky bet, that bet ended up paying off, as Nail Yakupov cited that he wanted to go to the OHL as a much clearer and much faster path to making his dreams happen at the National Hockey League. And that would reign true, as his first couple of seasons in Sarnia were absolutely prolific. His first season in the OHL in 2010-2011, where he just lit up the league, showed what Nail Yakupov could truly do when it comes to his hockey talent. He ended up putting up 101 points, 49 goals, 52 assists in 65 games, and would be just a fantastic talent looking ahead to the 2012 draft as the man and the most likely guy to be picked first overall. But what really added fuel to the fire was what he continued to do in the World Juniors 4-team Russia. In the U18 tier for the World Juniors, he got 7 games played, 6 goals, 7 assists, for 13 points. He ended up leading that tournament as a guy that wasn't even in his draft year. And going into the next season, things were looking bright, with also top pick Alex Galchenyuk. Those two absolutely destroyed the OHL when healthy and went on the top of their game, were both guys that were looked at as not just top picks, but could be inside the top three, with Nail Yakupov as the projected number one guy, and Alex Galchenyuk at least projected as a top five pick in the 2012 draft. In terms of the stats that Nail Yakupov put up, in 42 games with the Sarnia Sting, he got 31 goals, 38 assists for 69 points. And in the World Juniors, although he didn't record a goal, he played 7 games, getting 9 assists, tied for the most in the tournament, and got 9 points in total. And for a guy in his draft year to be well over a point per game in terms of point totals, that was looked at as a major success and overall a really successful draft year. Although he wasn't looked at as a generational prospect, this was a guy that was looked at as a confirmed, almost as sure as it gets, first overall pick, and a guy that would be the top pick in the 2012 draft. Although he wouldn't be a Sidney Crosby or anything, he would be looked at as a pretty fantastic overall prospect, and a guy that in terms of skill could pretty much do it all offensively. And that hard work in the OHL would definitely pay off. Whereas in Pittsburgh in June 22nd, 2012, the next NHL draft was hosted featuring the next grove and the next crop of NHL stars. And with the first overall pick, the Edmonton Oilers have the pick and they selected winger from the OHL, the Sarnia Sting, Nail Yakupov. But even though this was a fantastic moment for Nail Yakupov and the Oilers, it did not come without its controversies. Apparently, 9 out of the 11 head scouts for the Oilers wanted to go with Ryan Murray, the defenseman, as the first overall pick. But Steve Tambellini did not want that to happen. He picked Nail Yakupov, he had the final say, and the rest would be history. Ryan Murray would go to the Columbus Blue Jackets, then it would be Galchenyuk to the Montreal Canadiens, and that is your top three in the 2012 NHL entry draft. So even though they had the first overall pick, and they went with the guy that was most claimed to be the best prospect of the draft and the likely number one guy, even within that, the Edmonton Oilers organization and the people involved were still pretty mad. And even though this wouldn't bode well for Nail Yakupov's time with the Edmonton Oilers, he still had work to do. He had his first NHL season coming up at 18 years of age, hoping to make a big impact with the Edmonton Oilers. And to be fair, he did. Now, the 2012-2013 season was crazy for everybody. Obviously, we had the lockout shortened season, which meant that Nail Yakupov couldn't go for the full 82 games. But in the games he did play in the NHL, he was pretty good and was setting up to be worthy of a first overall pick. In 48 games, he got 17 goals, 14 assists for 31 points, which in terms of what he could have gotten in a full season, would have equated to around 53 points in terms of point per game pace. He ended up playing also in the KHL because of the lockout, getting 22 games played, 9 goals, 9 assists for 18 points. And that was pretty fantastic too. To be at his age, to put up those point totals and to look good as well was really important for Nail Yakupov's development. Sadly, this would be the best year of Nail Yakupov's career, no doubt. He was great in the NHL, he was great in the KHL, and things were looking up. And then 2014 happened. And after an incredible 2013 where he was effective in the NHL and the KHL, 2014 was just not the same way. But let's just look at it as a blip in the system. Maybe in 2015 he rebounds well and gets back to the track that he was on. Unfortunately, 2015 also did not go his way. He did play close to a full season, 81 games played, getting 14 goals, 19 assists for 33 points. And for an NHL player, that's pretty good. But if you're in Nail Yakupov's case, where you're a first overall pick and expecting to make some big time progress after 2014, not exactly what you would have liked. Now, his ice time kind of dwindled as well. His opportunity dwindled as his reach with the Edmonton Oilers organization kind of started to dwindle as well. This was a player that was not deserving of that ice time, wanted that ice time, didn't really do anything to deserve that ice time, and was kind of in that endless loop that you see with young NHL players not getting the opportunity that they could. In Nail Yakupov's case, he was not good. In those early years after 2013, he was a bad player defensively. He just was not there. And offensively, he wasn't as engaged even strength as he would have liked to have seen in a first overall pick. Power play-wise, sure, he was good, but the opportunities there were limited. And in a case where he was at in 2015, where he already was kind of losing grip of that system and the Edmonton Oilers coaching, it was just a bad mix overall. And then you get into the last and final season he was with the Edmonton Oilers in 2015-2016. He would fail to have a complete season, playing 60 games, getting 8 goals, 15 assists for 23 points. Sure, all right statistics for an NHL player. But again, in Nail Yakupov's case, it was just disastrous. He was getting less and less ice time, less and less opportunity, and he was still not improving in the ways he needed to improve. He didn't gain trust in the coaching, they didn't give the opportunities they needed to really succeed offensively, and it was about time that a change was in order. On October 7th, 2016, Nail Yakupov's time in Edmonton was finally over. He was traded to the St. Louis Blues for practically nothing, but this was a player that needed a fresh start. After the 2016 season especially, where he really didn't make any progress at all, this was a player that needed a right direction, a right franchise, and a new leadership group to actually lead him to the promised land. He still had skill, he still had potential, and St. Louis wanted to unlock it. Unfortunately, in the 2016-2017 season, he would end up being scratched a boatload of times and only play about about half of the games, 40 games played under his belt with 3 goals, 6 assists for 9 points. Now, to give Yakupov some credit, he didn't improve a lot defensively, especially in his time with St. Louis, but by the time that he actually improved substantially defensively, the damage had already been dealt, and his offensive abilities just paled in comparison. He really didn't get that much ice time, didn't get that much power play ice time, and that's what he really needed to flourish in a team like St. Louis, to get a clean new opportunity and gain the trust of the coaches, which is just not what he was able to do. Sure, he was effective as a bottom six guy, but as Nail Yakupov was what he was supposed to be, he was a shell of what he could have been, a shell of what the potential was, and it was obvious that there basically was no room for him in a top six in the NHL, let alone even a roster spot at the National Hockey League level. But wait just a second. After the 2017 season, the Colorado Avalanche just said, hey, we'll give him a 1-year contract, see what happens, and see what we can do with Nail Yakupov. And this was a different situation from St. Louis. St. Louis was a lot more of a defensive style team. Meanwhile, for the Colorado Avalanche, especially in that 2018 season, they were looking pretty good and on the up and up, and a team that definitely could have had the roster spots and the power play time that Nail Yakupov could have really used. And this would end up being the final nail in the coffin in his NHL career, where in 2017-2018, for the Colorado Avalanche, he played 58 games, getting 9 goals, 7 assists, for 16 points. As like a fourth line player, that's not too bad. But Nail Yakupov was a guy that needed that ice time, needed that efficiency, and it was obvious that, again, in a St. Louis time, it was almost over from that potential, but Colorado was most important there. He actually started off pretty decent with the Avs, if I remember correctly, but this was a player that just could not keep consistent, could not keep a good amount of ice time, and wherever he went, it was pretty much a disaster. He was an all right player for the Avs, but not a right fit, and right after that season, right after that contract, finds himself after the 1-year contract, going right back to Russia and back to the KHL. After 6 seasons in the NHL, 8 head coaches, from the Oilers to the Blues to the Avs, from all the turmoil to all the chaos, Nail Yakupov headed back to Russia after his 1-year deal with the Avs and headed back to the KHL. In 2018-2019, it would be actually pretty successful. We're in 47 games for SKA. He got 23 goals, 10 assists for 33 points, which is nothing to scoff at. So it was looking like a potential good move for Yakupov. Maybe play in the KHL for the next few years, rack up maybe some more potential, come back like maybe Ilya Kovalchuk or Alexander Radulov did, and maybe make a case for still being in the NHL. But in the 2019-2020 season, it wouldn't exactly go his way either, where with SKA, he got 20 points, a much down, much more lesser role with SKA, 20 points, 10 goals, 10 assists in 46 games. And this would be kind of the downfall for even him in the KHL, where things just did not work out whatsoever. He was traded for cash considerations in the KHL, and he was with Amur Karbagisk and Avangard Omsk this season, at least in 2021, and so far, at least compiling the stats, has played 29 games thus far, getting 5 goals, 9 assists for, up to this point, at least 14 points. Not the worst thing in the world, but this was a player that, again, was a first overall pick, was looked at as one of the best young prospects in the world, one of the best next Russians in the world, and now is getting traded for cash considerations in the KHL, can't really find a consistent job there, and has already gone through 3 teams in Russia. Not exactly the greatest look, and for his career, for his chances of getting back to the NHL, it's not looking too great, to be woefully honest with y'all. This is kind of where we get into the sad part of the video, sorry, but Nail Yakupov, from a first overall pick to basically a KHL scrub, is a guy that's had chances left, right, center, has been through it all, multiple NHL teams, multiple KHL teams, multiple franchises, organizations, opportunities, programs. Nail Yakupov has been through it all and has seen it all and has gotten all the opportunities along the way. Sure, sometimes he would like to have some more ice time and some power play time here or there, with especially Colorado or something, would have definitely helped, but it still stands that Nail Yakupov had the chances in the NHL. He had the opportunities to really show himself as not even just a first overall talent, just an NHL top six talent in general. This was a guy that was going into the Edmonton Oilers as such a prolific offensive goal scorer and even assist man as well in the OHL. A guy that was just so amazingly skilled offensively, had so much talent, and was looking to really burst at the NHL level. Unfortunately, some of the issues with skating, some of the issues with defensive play caught up to him, and when he was able to actually fix those issues, it was far too late and far too over for his chances, not just in the NHL, but in the hockey world in general. And we can play the blame game forever with Nail Yakupov. Obviously, Nail Yakupov had a lot to do with his downfall. Of course, he was the player behind the wheel. But you have the Edmonton Oilers, who sucked during Nail Yakupov's time and still didn't really give him the power play time that I think he kind of deserved at some points. And also the pressure, I think, definitely did affect things a lot. A lot of people don't really talk about it too much, but when you're a 17-year-old, 18-year-old kid, lauded as the next hockey superstar, to be able to fulfill those potentials, to be able to fulfill those expectations in a market like Edmonton, no less, is super hard to do. We've obviously seen guys like Leon Draisaitl and Connor McDavid do it since, but it's almost a superhuman trait to be able to block that all out and still come out the other side as this amazing, prolific goal scorer. Unfortunately, in Nail Yakupov's case, it seems he wasn't able to handle that and he wasn't able to completely do it. But honestly, as a guy that goes through some of that stuff as well, I completely know how it feels. And in Nail Yakupov's case, he's a guy that I'm kind of rooting for a little bit. Whether it be in hockey, whether it be after hockey, I think Nail Yakupov has some amazing potential, and I'm just hoping wherever he goes, he's happy, he's doing well, and I'm wishing him the best. Absolutely. He's an absolute stud. I will remember all the memories of failing for Nail, and I don't know. I just think he's an absolute beauty still, and a guy that wherever he goes, I wish the best for him. But that is going to be it for today, guys. Thanks so much for watching. This video has taken a while to put together, but this has probably been the most fun I've ever had on any video ever. And for me, at least, it's probably turned out into my favorite video I've ever made. So if you enjoyed, hit that like button, but most importantly, hit that subscribe button, join the Grav Gang, and hit that notification bell as well to get notified on all the new videos. Make sure you comment down below, what do you think of Nail Yakupov's story, his journey, and his road, and how it's landed him now? And also, comment down below all your thoughts. Make sure you share this video with your friends. Get the Nail Yakupov story out there, boys, right now, or else share it with everybody you know that likes hockey and click on this card right here to watch. You know, I'm going to make you watch right now. Right now, this is going to be a good one. 13 players, or actually 12 players, were drafted before Nick Suzuki in the 2017 draft. Where are they now? Let's see. Click on that card right here to watch that video. Absolutely worth it. I can absolutely attest to that. Thanks so much for watching, all of you. Absolutely appreciate it. My name is Nathan. Fail for Nail, baby. I'll see you in the next video or stream. Goodbye.